Good morning, church family. Pastor Thad with your midweek devotion. We're in week 10, which is the question and answer number 10 of the shorter catechism. And remember, the catechism is framing from a big picture of what is the purpose of all things: to glorify God, enjoy Him forever, and to narrow that down to, well, who is this God? What kind of being, what kind of divine being is He? And then what has He done? What has He made? What is He about? He's about His decrees of work and providence. Creation is what He's done in our world. He's made everything. We saw last time he's made everything out of nothing in the space of 6 days, and all very good. And now we're getting down to, well, what is creation? What's the pinnacle of creation? Well, it's actually people, human beings, man. And so we get to the question today that helps us see, well, how did God create man? And this is a great question, because it's not just, did God create man? But it includes this really important first question: how? What man is like? What kind of human being are we? We're a being. What kind of being are we? And this is hugely important. I want to unpack this and get to Psalms and Genesis and the commentary. But I want to frame this in the sense of the way our world is portraying. There's so many segmented pieces that are then elevated to try to encapsulate or to compose the entirety of what a human person is about. In other words, we're either walking brains, so all you need to do is fill your brain with as much wonderful things or as much joyful thoughts or as much information that functions well for you to your desire end, and then you've achieved. Or if you don't have some issue, what is the problem? Well, you've got some logical or rational problem that you just need to think your way through. And so we're walking toothpicks with heads on top. And that's not the entirety of who we are. The other major option, I mean, there's a lot of gradations of this in between, but the other option is that we're walking bits of emotion. Aristotle calls it the gut, right? The gut is the center of feeling for him, where my desires and wants and hopes, wishes, right? And so if I can just get all of my feelings met, all of my cravings fulfilled, my desires needed, all those things met, then I'll be happy. I'll be the end all be all of what I've wanted, and I'll be okay. And so if I wish upon a star and everything comes out nice, and I mean, we can find ample examples of how that is not true. I mean, pick a celebrity, follow their career, a Super Bowl winning athlete. Day after he wins the ring, he's got it on his finger. He's like, I got to go back and win another one. I can't be satisfied. I got to constantly long for more. What is really important about this question, how did God create man, is that man is created for glory, for great and beautiful things, with our head intact, rational thinking beings, with our desires there, with deep feelings, and they need to be connected in a way that's really significant, and I want to get to that momentarily. But first, the question, how did God create man? Well, this is how. God created man, male and female, both importantly human, after His own image. And this is really important. So we're mirrors. We're representing the very image of God. And what does that look like? So it's not a physical image. Obviously, He's not got this face or this nose or anything, right? God doesn't have a body until the incarnate Christ. And then, thankfully, we don't have any pictures of Him, so we don't know what He looks like. But the way that we're representing God after His own image, or in His image, is taken back to the way that kings in the ancient days used to put up statues around their territory to say, I've claimed this land. I'm putting out my stewards, my image bearers, to say, I am in charge of this land, and I'm imaging forth these representatives to have dominion, to take charge of what is mine. Well, the areas that God has done that, and this question and answer helps us get there, where has God put us as His image bearers forth? What areas are we in charge of? How are we made like God? In knowledge, righteousness, holiness. So what we know and what we understand, what we experience in righteousness, being right in terms of a moral standard, and then in holiness, being set apart for a particular and glorious purpose. And so all of these have a moral aspect, a moral component to them. That's how we mostly represent and image forth God, is that we're moral beings. We have the capacity to know right and wrong, good and evil. And that's seen very clearly right after Genesis 1 in the fall, where Genesis 2 and 3, Adam and Eve have this capacity and they exercise their ability to choose against God's will, and they choose sin. And that taints every single aspect of who they are, who people are. What is really key here, and what I want to zoom in with Psalm 8, is that the Lord is majestic, and his name is in all the earth, and he's set his glory above the heavens, but out of the mouth of babies and infants, he's established strength. His name, he's put on our lips. In other words, he's given us his very name, and his name is full of his attributes. That's what Exodus 34 so clearly shows, is that this is Yahweh. This is the God who is, who will be, who he will be. And he's given us that name, and that's part of what it means that we are in his image. He's given us a reflecting piece of his glory. And that's incredible. And so what is man that you're mindful of him, God? What are we that you actually care about us? Well, the Son of Man that you care enough to look out for him. It's because we reflect God. We're a mirror of his goodness, of his holiness, his righteousness. And that's incredible. And so we've also been given dominion then over the creatures. And dominion is a way of saying we represent God's authority and reign, in a sense, to take care, to steward what is his, which is an incredible thing. So let's look at the historic commentary for a second. I know we're running out of time. But Richard Pratt says, take another look at yourself, as in look, go look in the mirror. Go check this out. God has declared that the person in your mirror, so you, is his regal, his kingly image. You're not perfect. That should be plain enough, as it is for all of us, right? Not just perfect in looking, or imperfect in the way we look, but imperfect in our heart, in our mind, in our soul. But you are still valuable because you are God's image. In God's eyes, you are as important as any king and as valuable as any nobleman who ever walked on this earth. Discard the lies of the world and joyfully acknowledge that the dignity God has lavished on you. I want to zoom in on that last phrase. The lies of the world come up in those two ways. So I'm a walking brain. So my function is how much I can think and rationalize and how useful that is, how utilitarian that is for the society or for my, fill in the blank. Or in order to be full as my in my being, I need to just exercise all of the desires, all of the gut cravings that I have. And once I can do that, or to the degree that I can do that, I am happy. Yay, sing a song. And so the lie of the world that we need to discard is that my value is tied to my function. How much can you accomplish? That doesn't add any value to me. God sees me as precious in his sight before and despite anything I do wrong or right. Sorry, that didn't mean for that to rhyme. That just how it came out. And also, the other side of that is my desires don't make me more valuable if and when I achieve them. That's not how it works. What I love about this Pratt quote is one thing. I was listening to a commentary. I'll put the link in the notes. From Chuck Colson Center, John Stone Street does a Breakpoint podcast. And he was talking about one of C.S. Lewis's brilliant descriptions of who the human person is. Sorry, I can't even say it. And he does this in terms of looking at C.S. Lewis's set of opinion essays called The Abolition of Man. The first one is Men Without Chests. And it doesn't mean a guy without this. It means what's the chest, the seat of the heart is where the chest lies, right? That's what is there. So the heart is that place where the brain and the gut connect, and not just what is thoughtful or rational or what is deeply desired and craved, but what is virtuous. The heart is the seat of what is moral and right and good and best, what is honorable. And he says, and C.S. Lewis unpacks this a lot better, but John Stone Street says, that's what we're missing today. And some of it is from, he hits it from an educational perspective. Some of it, he hits it from a worldview and a the way that we're being informed and transformed by the world around us that tells us either we're a brain or that we're a set of feelings and we just need to express those and then find them fulfilled in our who we think we are as people. Our sexuality is then emphasized. If I can just get this, or our rational thought is overemphasized, if I can get this degree, or if I can have this job and this career, or if people will see me and affirm me for this ability that I have. And we forget that God has built us with a heart and a soul. And that's so beautiful. Well, we're running out of time. Let me close with a prayer, and I hope that as you listen to maybe this podcast on Breakpoint, that you think more about the person that God has made you, that you are infinitely valuable. Long before you did a single thing, he knit you together in your mother's womb, and there's the point of your value, that God created you and me. And everything that we get to do then is just reflecting how glorious it is that God is the creator. And how good it is that he's put, yes, desires in us and thoughts that we can think, but he's given us virtue to see what is best and to do what is best for his glory. Let's pray from the Valley of Vision. Plow deep in me, great Lord, that my being may be tilled field, the roots of grace spreading far and wide until you alone are seen in me. Thy beauty, golden like summer harvest, thy fruitfulness as autumn plenty. So God, be deeply seated, deeply rooted in my heart, where your virtue and your goodness are, so that my value can be amplified by pursuing your glorious purposes in our lives and in the world. We pray in Jesus' name. All right, y'all have a blessed day, and we'll see you next time. If you have any thoughts or questions, don't hesitate. We'll be around.